Well, the United States and its allies, Japan, or the whole of Europe, Western Europe and Central Europe in NATO, alliances across the Middle East, this remains by far and away the most powerful military political alliance the world has ever seen. But the problem is it's fallible, and that even with all of those resources, it was defeated in Iraq and defeated in Afghanistan. One might say they got the force, but they haven't got the skill or the willingness to use it. And of course, one could say that this is actually a result of the progress of civilization, because frankly, 50 or 100 years ago, a country like the United States would have simply used nuclear weapons on Afghanistan or used nuclear weapons on Iraq. And if there had been insurgents, they would just have exterminated hundreds of thousands of people. You know, Hitler or Genghis Khan or indeed Napoleon wouldn't have thought twice. But fortunately, we live in a world in which we realize that we cannot use massive force anymore like this. But that realization has yet to really make its way through into policy, to realize that we need overall to pursue more peaceful policies much more strongly. I think you have to make a pretty broad definition of conflict and I guess they would say, well, France has maybe got some problems with Corsica. These sorts of issues have been around for millennia, and they're probably always going to be around. The issue is, do they get out of hand, and do you have miscalculation? And I think one of the huge problems is that you have a dislocation between political leadership in Moscow, in Washington, other places, who really don't have the experience and the intelligence to face up to the fact that in a world of nuclear weapons, one really has to work for their abolition. Now, President Obama has said some things and tried to get his administration to do this, but it's interesting that one of his officials had the nerve to write an article for one of the journals saying how we could get rid of nuclear weapons, and promptly got sacked for writing an article about implementing the president's policy. So you can see there is entrenched opposition.
Do you think America didn't go into Ukraine because of the fear of nuclear weapons? They also didn't want to fall out with Putin, especially after MH17 got shot down outside Ukraine.
I think that is indeed part of it. That, as the one of the officers says in Dr. Strangelove, we don't want to get into world war unless we really have to. And indeed, you know, what are we going to do? Where are we going to stop in fighting in Ukraine? Even if there wasn't nuclear weapons, are we really going to send the Scots Guards to invade Moscow because of the dispute in Ukraine? And of course, from the Russian perspective, they have a point. You know, the borders of Ukraine are not that historically valid. While the Ukraine government is now democratically elected, at the time, and a democratically elected government was kicked out by the protesters. So there are two sides to all of this, and it shouldn't just be left to Mr. Farage to point out that Putin has a point. There are advantages, obviously, because many countries have them and other countries want to have them, and they think this is the ultimate guarantee of their survival as a country. So even, you know, a little country like Belgium is allowed to have some nuclear weapons sharing with the United States, for heaven's sake. And if Belgium is allowed to have American nuclear weapons, why shouldn't everybody? So they are thought to be desirable. The problem is, the attitude is that we need to have them because they keep us safe, because it's a nasty world, therefore we need to have nuclear weapons. The problem is, if it's that nasty, they're going to end up being used. And the people who want to have nuclear weapons, or think we have to have them, really try to have the best of both worlds. They want to say the world is so nasty that we have to have them, but it isn't so nasty that we'll end up using them by accident or some other reason. And you only have to say, how much of human history do we have to have with nuclear weapons before they go off? You know, you only have to turn on the television, never mind 1914, but we're forever seeing programs about Henry VIII or Norman invasion. Are we really saying if William the Conqueror had had nuclear weapons and Harold had had nuclear weapons, that England would still be Saxon and there would not have been a war since? Obviously, this is nonsense. Obviously, human society has to get to grips with this fundamental problem of its existence. And you see more and more, not just from nuclear weapons, but the central challenge for human society today is the self-destructive nature of industry. Nuclear weapons, the environment, global warming, all of these have taught us that either we learn to control industrial technology or it will come back and bite us. And how many times do we have to learn the lesson? And it's, I think, of vital interest as we look towards the anniversary, not just of 1914-18, which produced the failure of the League of Nations, the rise of Hitler. In 1945, the winners didn't say, oh, well, that League of Nations was a little rubbish. Let's not bother with that. Let's just go back to force and alliances and not bother with the global institution. No, they built the UN. And the task for us is, through the UN, other institutions, to build on that real legacy and not, I mean, it would be a real Greek tragedy that, that, you know, the ancient Greeks would enjoy the failure of the human personality. It's what they wrote wonderful plays about, that we throw away all the lessons we learned out of two world wars on the need for global cooperation, on the need to invest in making sometimes unpleasant deals with the likes of Putin to get a stable and more peaceful global order with more human rights, that we throw all of that away and think that might is right, we don't need the UN, and that we don't fundamentally need to have a global policy which bases economic policy on prosperity and high employment, and doesn't understand that mass unemployment in the Middle East and elsewhere is a central cause of instability. That was understood universally in 1945. Sadly, our leaders don't understand it today. There's a huge amount of misinformation. I don't think there's ever been a real mea culpa in the media for telling everybody that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. The government got blamed, but you can't say that the media has been more critical of government since over other issues, even though the public are highly skeptical. Yes, the media will play a role, but I have to say this is probably the first interview I've had on this topic directly about World War III in perhaps 20 years, that there has been huge resistance in the media to covering, for example, the story of the drunken and gambling American missile generals that only got into, I think, the New Yorker Journal, read by, I think, 0.1% of Americans. And you'd have thought that would be on front page news. Similarly, there have been all sorts of accidents with Britain's nuclear weapons program over the years, which never get reported in the English papers. They occasionally get into the Scottish papers, but for some strange reason, they never make it into the English news. Well, in terms of underdogs, I mean, the international relations scholars would say, you know, a Chinese-America war is a betting certainty, that the rise of China, at some point they will build up their military, and at some point that will all go horribly wrong by miscalculation. I heard Henry Kissinger discussing this very recently, in which he said basically we have to work really hard at cultural understanding, because in the end the bureaucracies will get it wrong and we'll get into a Chinese-American war. The Chinese have been very restrained in their military, and we hear about the Chinese military build-up. We don't really hear about how massive the American capability is compared to the Chinese, or indeed the Russian these days. The rosy scenario is that in World War III, somebody makes a mistake and messes with the United States, and the United States just brushes them away with its conventional weapons and establishes global supremacy, and China and Russia are no longer a factor, and that's it for another century. That's kind of, as it were, the rosy scenario of World War III, in which America, with complete military supremacy, comes out on top. But frankly, if it goes horribly wrong, then nobody escapes. One of the issues is climate change, not climate chaos from carbon emissions, but if you let off a few hundred nuclear weapons, the amount of rubble that ends up in the atmosphere gives a global winter, because it blocks out the sun's rays, you have a massive agricultural failure, and billions of people to starve to death. There are historical precedents, I think 1816, after a huge volcanic explosion, was talked of as in Europe, on the other side of the world, as the year without a summer. It's perhaps most famous as the year in which Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein. But this was known in Europe as the year without a summer, massive crop failures and starvation. And that's just one volcano, not the rubble from countless nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. And it's all very well to say they would be used simply and rationally, and well, that's rosy scenario. But I think you just got to say that the same management, and indeed often the same people, who are in charge of Afghanistan or Ukraine policy, are also in charge of nuclear weapons. And indeed, I think one of the commanders that Obama sacked from his job in Afghanistan ended up running America's nuclear weapons. I think we'll be extraordinarily lucky if we don't have a global war in the next century. Extraordinarily lucky. And we have to realize that the First World War broke out after a century without global war. And that, therefore, on that basis, nuclear weapons have not given us any historically significant period of peace at all.
So it could happen at any time.
The greatest danger is that it's a bit like 1914, but everyone having forgotten there are armies, that we have these confrontations, but you don't see anybody going on television and saying, geez, we better work out what's going on with Putin, because he's got 2,000 nuclear weapons and here's where they are. And America's got these 1,000 nuclear weapons, and here's where they are, which is what you used to have 20 years ago or so in the time of the Cold War. Now we have these discussions as if nuclear weapons didn't exist. And if you ring up a newsroom and say, excuse me, what about the nuclear dimension? They think you're a nutter, to be frank. And I have to say, well, who's the nutter? I didn't invent the nuclear weapons. The nuclear weapons are sitting there. Why don't we have this discussion? Well, because no one would use them, no one would be aware of them. Well, if you have a generation of policymakers and media who have no idea what these weapons are, what they can do, and just a tiny group or small group of military people only who understand them, and they're the same people who've been running these rather disastrous wars, well, you don't have to conjure up an evil scenario of somebody deliberately attacking somebody else. You've only just got to say, well, not so much a conspiracy as a cock-up is the likely scenario.
So if it was to happen tomorrow and Russia and America went to war, it literally has to be the word of Obama and Putin to say, go, use the weapons. They get the final say. Is that how it works?
Well, actually, in theory, yes. In practice, both sides historically have given their soldiers the authority to use nuclear weapons without presidential say-so, as is now well documented. And again, from the immortal movie Dr. Strangelove, the president in that movie says, but General, I thought I was the only one to authorized to use nuclear weapons, to which the reply is, well, sir, it appears we have an unauthorized use. And that tragically is still the situation. The people at Chatham House, I think, recently conducted a study of the 13 men who had saved the world, 13 people who disobeyed orders during the Cold War and didn't use nuclear weapons.
If it did happen tomorrow, who do you think, what country do you think would come out on top?
Well, if there was a world war tomorrow afternoon, I think the bookies' favourite would be to say that the Americans would come all out on top without breaking sweat. But the bookies have been known to be wrong, and if they're wrong, we're all dead.